Hello everyone, welcome back. This is the 8th lecture on the topic impact of jet on curved vanes. In the last couple of lectures, we have discussed in detail the impact of jet on a curved vane when the jet enters the vane tangentially, and today we will see a few numerical examples, particularly examples involving the calculation of the impact of jet and the corresponding work done and efficiency of the jet when the jet strikes a curved vane and if the vane is moving. First, let us quickly glance through the concepts that will be used in this lecture. In case of an unsymmetrical curved vane, with a jet entering the vane tangentially, and if the vane is moving with a velocity u in a direction different from that of the velocity of the jet v, we need to draw the velocity triangles to find the relative velocity. The impact of the jet and the work done can be expressed in terms of the relative velocity, and we have also seen the expression for the efficiency. So, in these expressions, rho is the mass density of the fluid, A is the cross-sectional area of the jet, Vr is the relative velocity with which the jet is striking the vane, Vw and Vw1 are the velocity of whirl at the inlet and the outlet respectively, V and V1 are the absolute velocity of the jet at the inlet and the outlet respectively, u is the velocity with which the vane is moving. We also need to remember the velocity triangles that are the inlet and the outlet. The inlet velocity triangle consists of the absolute velocity of the jet V and the velocity of the vane u, and the closing side of this triangle gives the relative velocity at the inlet, that is Vr. The absolute velocity V makes an angle alpha with u at the inlet, and the relative velocity when it is tangential to the vane makes an angle theta with the direction of motion of the vane at the inlet. Alpha is known as the jet angle and theta is known as the vane angle at the inlet. The components of the absolute velocity along the direction of u and perpendicular to that are known as velocity of whirl Vw and the velocity of flow Vf respectively at the inlet. Similarly, the outlet velocity triangle can be obtained using Vr1, that is the relative velocity at the outlet, and u1, which is the velocity of the vane at the outlet. These two are inclined at an angle phi, where phi is the vane angle at the outlet, and we can draw the closing side of the triangle V1, and V1 gives the magnitude and the direction of the absolute velocity at the outlet. V1 is inclined at an angle beta to the direction of motion of the vane at the outlet, and this angle beta is known as the jet angle at the outlet. Again, V1 can be resolved into components along the direction of u1 and perpendicular to that, and these components are known as velocity of whirl at the outlet and velocity of the flow at the outlet. Once the velocity triangle is constructed, any of the principles of trigonometry can be applied to the velocity triangle as well. For example, sine rule, cosine rule, etc. When do we use sine rule? When do we use cosine rule? Sine rule is generally used when we know the angles, like two angles of a triangle, and one of the side is known to us. Then we can find the remaining sides by applying the sine rule. In a triangle, we know that sum of the included angles is equal to 180. Therefore, say for example, if we know the angle A and angle B, we can calculate angle C. Angle C is equal to 180 minus A plus B. Similarly, if the side AB is known to us, we can apply sine rule to find the other two unknown sides. The sine rule states that in a triangle, the ratio of the length of a side divided by sine of the opposite angle remains constant. That is, if you take the length of the side AB, AB divided by sine of opposite angle, that is sine C, is equal to the length BC divided by sine A, that should be equal to the length AC divided by the sine of opposite angle, that is sine B. So, if we know the side AB and if we know all these angles A, B and C, we can find BC and AC. That is how we use sine rule. And cosine rule is generally used if we know one angle and the two adjacent sides. Then we can solve the triangle by using the cosine rule. For example, in this case, assume that the side AB and BC are known to us, and also the included angle B. Side AB and BC are known to us and the included angle B. In that case, we can determine AC as AC square is equal to AB square plus BC square minus 2 times AB into BC into cos of the included angle, that is cos B. That's how we can use cosine rule. The same thing can be extended to velocity triangles as well. You can see that this is the velocity triangle at the inlet, and in this velocity triangle, absolute velocity of the jet V is known to us. Say velocity of the vane U is also known to us. Assume that V and U are known to us, and also the vane angle at the inlet theta is known to us. Jet angle at the inlet alpha is also known to us. In that case, by applying the principles of trigonometry, this angle here is 180 minus theta, and we can also determine that this angle is theta minus alpha. So in this triangle, say A, B, C, by applying sine rule, since B and U are known to us, since all three angles are known to us, we can determine VR. Say V by sine 180 minus theta is equal to U divided by sine theta minus alpha is equal to VR divided by sine alpha. This can be used to find VR. Similarly, if you want to find VF or VW, we can take this angle theta such that tan theta is equal to VF divided by VW minus U, this distance, which is VW minus U. And we know that VF is V sin alpha and VW is V cos alpha. Therefore, tan theta can be written as V cos alpha divided by V sin alpha minus U. This is just one method or some of the equations that we generally use to solve the velocity triangle. Similarly, here you can see the outlet velocity triangle. Assume that in the outlet velocity triangle, VR1 is known to us and U1 is known to us. The vane angle at the outlet phi is known to us, and say beta is also known to us. So in this case, you know the two sides and the included angle. Therefore, you can find V1 by applying the cosine rule such that V1 square is equal to VR1 square plus U1 square minus 2 times VR1 into U1 into cos phi. That is V1 square equal to VR1 square plus U1 square minus 2 into VR1 into U1 cos phi. Similarly, if you want to find VW1 or VF1, you can consider this triangle, and here we can write that tan beta is equal to VF1 divided by VW1, where VF1 is VR1 sin phi and VW1 is VR1 cos phi minus U1. Again, these are some of the typical methods that we follow in the numerical examples. Now, let us move on to some of the numerical examples. The first one goes like this. A jet of water moving at 20 meters per second impinges on a symmetrical curved vane shaped to deflect the jet through 120 degree. Vane angle at the inlet and outlet are equal, and it is equal to 30 degrees. If the vane is moving at 5 meters per second, the first part is calculate the angle of the jet so that there is no shock at the inlet. Second part is determine the absolute velocity of the jet at the exit in magnitude and direction. Third part is work done by the jet, that is work done per unit time. So, first we need to identify what type of problem is this. We have seen the impact of jet various cases. What type of problem is given and what are the data given in this case? So, we can see that a jet is impinging on a vane and the vane is moving at 5 meters per second and the jet is deflected through 120 degrees. So, this is the case of a curved vane and the jet impinging the vane tangentially, and the vane is also moving. So, we know that this kind of problems can be solved by drawing the velocity triangle. So, let us next identify what all are given. So, jet of water is moving at 20 meters per second. That means the velocity of the jet is 20 meters per second, that is V equal to 20 meters per second, and it impinges on a symmetrical vane. Vane is symmetrical and it deflects the jet through 120 degree. Deflects the jet through 120 degree. So, in this case, the deflection angle is 180 minus theta plus phi. 180 minus theta plus phi is the deflection angle. So that is given here. This is 180 minus theta plus phi, and in this case it's mentioned symmetrical vane, that is theta and phi are equal and each is equal to 30 degrees. It's very evident because 180 minus theta plus phi is 120 degree. So theta plus phi is 60 degree. Since theta and phi are equal, theta is equal to phi is equal to 30 degree. It is evident, or it is also explicitly mentioned in the numerical problem. Next, it is mentioned that if the vane is moving at 5 meters per second, this 5 meter per second is the velocity of the vane, that is u is equal to 5 meters per second. So these are the information given to us, that is v is 20 meters per second, theta is equal to phi is equal to 30 degrees, and u is equal to 5 meters per second. Next, we need to see what all need to be determined. Calculate the angle of the jet so that there is no shock at the inlet, that is the jet is entering the vane tangentially, that is what is meant by there is no shock at the inlet. Vr is tangential to the vane at the inlet. Calculate the angle of the jet. Angle of the jet angle at the inlet, that is represented as alpha. So first part of the question is to determine alpha, and second part, determine the absolute velocity of the jet at the exit in magnitude and direction. Absolute velocity of the jet at the outlet is represented as v1. So we need to find the magnitude of v1 and its direction. So what is the direction that v1 makes with the direction of motion of the vane, that is what is the angle beta at the outlet. This is the direction of the absolute velocity at the outlet, that is jet angle at the outlet. The third part is work done by the jet, or work done per unit time, that is Wx. Then we need to determine the efficiency of the jet. So we need to determine the jet angle at the inlet alpha, absolute velocity of the jet at the exit v1 and its direction beta, work done, that is Wx, and the efficiency eta. These are the information given in the question. Now we know that it's a case of a moving curved vane. We need to draw the velocity triangle. So first we need to draw the vane, then we need to draw the absolute velocity of the jet v at the inlet, velocity of the vane u, such that these two are inclined at an angle alpha, and the closing side is vr. Vr makes an angle theta with the direction of u, and the component of v along the direction of u is vw, perpendicular to that is vf, which completes the inlet velocity triangle. And at the outlet we have to draw the velocity triangle by drawing vr1 inclined at an angle phi along the direction u1, and the with respect to the direction u1, and the closing side is the absolute velocity v1, which is inclined at an angle beta with respect to u1. And the component of v1 along the direction of u1 is vw1, perpendicular to that is vf1. This is the positive x direction, this is the positive y direction. That completes the inlet and the outlet velocity triangles. Now we need to analyze this. So from the inlet velocity triangle we need to determine alpha. In the inlet velocity triangle we can apply the sine rule. So in the inlet velocity triangle we know that if this angle is alpha and this angle is theta, this angle is 180 minus theta, and this angle will be theta minus alpha. This is alpha, this is 180 minus theta, this angle is theta, this angle will be theta minus alpha. With that understanding, if we apply the sine rule, so if I draw the velocity triangle in a larger sketch, this side is v, and we have u, and the closing side is vr. This angle is theta, this is 180 minus theta, this angle is alpha, and this is theta minus alpha. So if we apply sine rule here, V divided by sine 180 minus theta is equal to U divided by sine theta minus alpha is equal to VR divided by sine alpha. Let me repeat, V divided by the sine of the opposite angle. So V divided by sine 180 minus theta is equal to VR divided by sine alpha is equal to U divided by sine theta minus alpha. So in this case, we know the value of V and U. So we can write it as 20 divided by sine 180 minus theta is 30. This is equal to U. U is 5 divided by sine theta, that is 30 minus alpha, and that should be equal to VR divided by sine alpha. So if we take these two terms together, all except alpha is known to us. Therefore, we can solve for this and get the value of alpha. Similarly, if we take the first and the last one, now we know the value of alpha, substitute the value of alpha, and if you equate these two, we can get the value of VR. Thus, we can determine alpha, that is the jet angle at the inlet, and we can also determine the relative velocity at the inlet. So, if we substitute all these values and calculate, we will get alpha is equal to 22 degrees 49 minutes and VR equal to 15.51 meter per second. Thus, we got the value of alpha, that is we have answered the first part of the question, jet angle at the inlet, and we have also determined VR, that is relative velocity at the inlet. Now, since nothing is mentioned in the question, let us assume that the vane is smooth and frictionless, which means that the relative velocity at the inlet is the same as the relative velocity at the outlet. There is no energy loss due to friction taking place, and therefore the relative velocity remains the same. So VR is equal to VR1, and that is equal to 15.51 meters per second. And we have also seen that for a single curved vane, it is reasonably good to assume that the inlet tip and the outlet tip are moving with the same velocity. That means we can assume that U is equal to U1, and that is given as 5 meters per second. Now, if you consider this outlet velocity triangle, VR1 is known to us, U1 is known to us, and this angle, vane angle at the outlet phi, is known to us. So in a triangle, we know two sides and the included angle. Therefore, we can apply the cosine rule to find the unknown side, that is V1. That is V1 square is equal to U1 square plus VR1 square minus 2 times U1 into VR1 into cos of this angle phi. That is V1 square equal to U1 square plus VR1 square minus 2 times U1 into VR1 into cos phi. Again, we can substitute the value of U and VR1, that is U1 is 5, so 5 square plus VR1 is 15.51, so 15.51 square minus 2 times 5 into 15.51 into cos phi, vane angle at the outlet is 30. If you substitute and calculate, you will get the value of V1 as 11.46 meters per second. That is, that answers one part of the question, where V1 is the magnitude of the absolute velocity of the jet at the outlet. Now that we have determined the magnitude of the absolute velocity at the outlet, we also need to determine its direction. That means we need to determine the jet angle at the outlet beta. For that, let us consider the outlet velocity triangle. Let me write the name, or let me name the triangle, say A, B, C and D. Consider the triangle BCD. From this triangle BCD, you can write that tan theta is equal to CD divided by BC, that is equal to VF1 divided by VW1. How do we write this VF1 and VW1 in terms of known quantities? What are known to us? VR1 and U1 are the quantities known to us. So how do we write VF1 and VW1 in terms of VR1? So we know the magnitude of VR1, that is 15.51 meters per second. We know this angle at the outlet, jet vane angle at the outlet phi is equal to 30 degrees. So we know that VF1 is equal to VR1 sine phi. It's a sine component. VF1 is the sine component, and VW1 is equal to VW1, that is BC is equal to AC minus AB. AC is the cosine component, that is VR1 cos phi gives you AC. So that AC minus AB, AB is U1, gives us VW1, which means that by applying from the velocity triangle at the outlet, tan beta is equal to VF1 divided by VW1, VF1 divided by VW1. VF1 is VR1 sine phi. So VF1 is VR1 sine phi. VW1 is VR1 cos phi minus U1. VR1 cos phi minus U1. Now if we substitute the values of VR1 phi and U1, we will get tan beta is equal to VR1, that is 15.51 into sine phi is 30 degrees divided by VR1, that is 15.51 into cos 30 minus U1, U1 is 5. If we substitute all these values, we will get beta as 42 degrees 36 minutes. That completes the second part of the question. In the third part of the question, we need to determine work done by the jet on the vane per unit time. And we know the expression for work done per unit weight of the fluid. Since the area of the jet is not given to us, we cannot determine the work done per unit time, but we can determine work done per unit weight of the fluid, and that is given by Vw plus or minus Vw1 into U divided by G. And what is Vw? What is Vw1? We need to determine Vw and we need to determine Vw1. So from the inlet velocity triangle, Vw is given by V cos alpha. And we know the value of V, we know the value of alpha. So V is given by 20. So 20 cos alpha we have already determined, that is 22 degree 49 minutes. And we can see that Vw is equal to 18.44 meters per second. What is Vw1? Vw1 can be determined from the outlet velocity triangle as Vr1 cos phi minus u, or it can also be determined as V1 cos beta. Since we already know the value of V1 and beta, we can determine Vw1 as V1 cos beta. So in this case, this is equal to V1 is 11.46 into cos beta is 42 degrees 36 minutes. Upon substitution, you will get the value Vw1 equal to 8.43 meters per second. Now we need to substitute here. Which one we will use, whether we will use a positive sign or negative sign? That depends on the value of beta. So in this case, beta is 42 degree 36 minutes, which is less than 90 degree. We need to use the positive sign. So work done per unit weight of the fluid is given by Vw plus Vw1 into U divided by G. So substitute the values of Vw and Vw1, that is equal to 18.44 plus 8.43 into U. U is 5 meters per second, divided by acceleration due to gravity is 9.81, and this gives us the value as 13.70, and work done, it's Newton meter per second per Newton, because work done per unit time per unit weight of the fluid. That's the answer to the third part of the question. Now coming to the last part of the question, here we need to determine the efficiency of the jet. Efficiency is output power divided by input power. Output power we have determined as the work done per unit weight of the fluid per unit time. Therefore, input power we need to consider as the kinetic energy of the fluid per unit time per unit weight of the fluid. Kinetic energy per unit weight of the fluid. Kinetic energy, we know that it is half mv square, and this kinetic energy per unit weight of the fluid, to determine that we need to divide half mv square by the weight, that is mass into acceleration due to gravity. That gives us kinetic energy per unit weight of the fluid, or kinetic energy head, which is equal to v square by 2g. If we substitute the value of v as 20 and g as 9.81 meter per second square, the kinetic energy head or kinetic energy per unit weight of the fluid is given by 20.387 Newton meter per second per Newton, or this much meters per second. That is the kinetic energy head. Now, the efficiency is given by work done per unit weight of the fluid divided by kinetic energy per unit weight. That is 13.7 is the work done per unit weight. Kinetic energy per unit weight is 20.387. So, substituting these values, we will get efficiency as 0.6719, or expressed as a percentage, efficiency is 67.2%. That is the answer to the last part of the question. I hope all of you could solve the first problem. Moving on to a second, a jet of water moving at 35 meters per second impinges on a curved vane which is moving with a velocity of 20 meters per second. The jet makes an angle of 30 degrees to the direction of motion of the vane while entering, and it leaves the vane at an angle of 120 degrees. Draw the velocity triangles at the inlet and the outlet and determine the angle of vanes so that the water enters and leaves without shock. The work done per Newton, that is work done per unit weight of water entering the vanes, and the efficiency of the jet. In this case also, in the question, it is mentioned that the water enters and leaves without shock. That means water enters the vane tangentially and leaves the vane tangentially, and the vane is also moving. So, the case of a curved vane with water entering the vane tangentially, that is the case that we are talking about. And in this case, what are the informations given to us? The jet of water is moving at 35 meters per second, that is velocity of the jet V is equal to 35 meters per second, and the vane is moving at 20 meters per second, that is velocity of the vane U is equal to 20 meters per second. The jet makes an angle of 30 degrees to the direction of motion of the vane while entering. So, here you can see this is the direction of motion of the vane. The jet makes an angle 30 degrees to the direction of motion of the vane, which is the jet angle at the inlet, that is alpha is given as 30 degrees. And it is mentioned that the jet leaves the vane at an angle of 120 degrees. What is this 120 degree? So, let me draw the outlet velocity triangle in a slightly enlarged way. This is the outlet velocity triangle. Here, this is the direction of motion of the vane at the end. And the jet leaves at an angle 120 degrees. So, you have to consider this is the direction of motion of the vane, and this is the direction in which the jet is leaving. So, this angle which we write as beta dash is equal to 120 degrees. Therefore, beta, that is the jet angle at the outlet, beta is equal to 180 minus 120 degree, which is 60 degrees. So, I will write it as beta dash. Beta dash is given as 120 degrees. Now, draw the velocity triangle at the inlet and outlet and determine the angle of vanes so that the water enters and leaves the vane without shock. Vane angles are theta at the inlet and phi at the outlet. So, we need to determine theta and phi, and work done per unit weight of water entering the vane. So, Wx per unit weight of water. That is what you need to determine. So if you list the values that are given to us, it's mentioned that velocity v is equal to 35 meters per second, velocity of the vane is 20 meters per second, that is u, alpha is 30 degrees and beta is equal to 120 degrees. You need to determine vane angles theta and phi and work done per unit weight of the liquid. So these are the information given to us. Since beta dash is given, we can calculate beta as 180 minus 120, that is 60 degree. And the first step is to draw the velocity triangle. We need to draw the vane with the jet striking the vane tangentially. Draw the inlet velocity triangle with V and U with an angle alpha in between. The closing side is VR, inclined at an angle theta. And draw the component of V along the tangential and radial direction, that is VW and VF. At the outlet, start drawing the velocity triangle with VR1, then draw U1 with an angle phi in between, and the closing side is V1, which is inclined at an angle beta, then draw the component VF1 and VW1 of V1. That completes the outlet velocity triangle. Also mark the direction X and Y. Now, the first part of the question asks the vane angle at the inlet and the outlet, that is theta and phi. Let's consider the inlet velocity triangle. Let me name it, say A, B, C, D. So you consider the triangle ACD. In this triangle ACD, you can write, if you want to know theta, tan theta is equal to AD divided by CD, so that you can write this is equal to VF divided by VW minus U. That is, from the inlet velocity triangle, tan theta is VF divided by VW minus U. What is VF and what is VW? You consider the triangle ABD. Consider the triangle ABD. VF, that is the side AD, is equal to AB sine alpha. Alpha is this angle. So you consider the triangle ABD, AD equal to AB sine alpha, that is AB is V, V sine alpha is VF. Similarly, side BD is equal to AB cos alpha, that is V cos alpha gives you VW. So this is V sine alpha divided by V cos alpha minus U. That's what is written. Tan theta equal to VF divided by VW minus U. VF is V sine alpha, VW is V cos alpha minus U. The value of V, alpha and U are given. So if you substitute those values, say 35 sine 30 divided by 35 cos 30 minus 20 gives us theta is equal to 60 degrees. That is from the inlet velocity triangle. Now, to find the vane angle at the outlet, you need to analyze the outlet velocity triangle. That is possible only if you know the value of VR1. And in this case, let us assume that the vane is smooth and frictionless, which means that VR is equal to VR1. So, if you determine the value of VR from the inlet velocity triangle, the same can be assumed for VR1. So, how do we find VR? Since we know the angle theta and since we know VW, we know that this is a 90 degree triangle. There are different methods of doing it. I am just explaining only one method. So, this is a 90 degree triangle ACD. So, here you can apply sine rule, say VF divided by sine theta is equal to VR divided by sine 90. Thus, by applying the sine rule, you can determine the value of VR. VF divided by sine theta equal to VR divided by sine 90. The value of VF is V sine alpha, that is 17.50, and sine theta, theta is 60 degree we have determined, and if we substitute, we can get the value of VR, that is 20.25 meters per second. Another way of doing VR, another way of determining VR is in the triangle ACD. AC is the hypotenuse. So, AC square equal to CD square plus AD square. AD is VF and CD is VW minus U. Thereby, you can determine the value of VR. Any of the methods can be adopted provided the answer is correct. Now that we have determined the value of Vr, let us assume that this is smooth and frictionless vane. Therefore, Vr1 is equal to Vr, and another reasonably good assumption is U1 is equal to U. Velocity of the vane remains the same for the inlet tip as well as for the outlet tip. With these assumptions, we got some values for the outlet velocity triangle. We now know Vr1, we know U1, and also in the outlet velocity triangle, this angle is beta, and therefore, this angle is beta dash. Beta dash is 120 degree. This beta is 60 degree, beta dash is 120 degree. So, in this triangle, this angle is known to us, U1 is known to us, Vr1 is known to us, we need to determine phi. That is possible since we know Vr1 and beta dash. This can be solved by using sine rule, and we know this angle as beta minus phi, and this angle is phi. Therefore, by applying the sine rule to the outlet velocity triangle, U1 divided by sine beta minus phi is equal to Vr1 divided by sine beta dash. U1 divided by sine beta minus phi is equal to Vr1 divided by sine beta dash. Substituting the value of U1 is 20, beta is 60, phi is not known to us, that is what we need to determine. Vr1 is 20.25 and beta dash is 120 degree. Substituting the values, we can get phi is equal to 1.25 degrees or 1 degree 15 minutes. So, we have determined the vane angle at the inlet, that is theta, is equal to 60 degrees, and vane angle at the outlet, that is phi, is equal to 1.25 degrees. In the second part of this question, we need to determine work done per unit weight of water, and the expression for the same is 1 by g into Vw plus Vw1 into u. Well, g is the acceleration due to gravity, Vw and Vw1 are the velocity of work at the inlet and the outlet respectively. So, in the inlet velocity triangle, we know that Vw is equal to V cos alpha. Vw is equal to V cos alpha. Alpha is known to us, V is also known to us, we can find Vw. Similarly, in the outlet velocity triangle, Vw1 is equal to Vr1 cos phi minus U1. Vr1 cos phi minus U1. Vr1 is known to us, phi is known to us, and U1 is known to us. Therefore, we can determine the value of Vw1, and if we substitute these values, we will get work done per unit weight of water. That is Vw equal to V cos alpha, V is 35, 35 cos 30, and Vw1 is Vr1 cos phi minus U1, Vr1 is 20.25 into cos 1.25 minus 20, that is 0.25 meters per second. Substituting the value of Vw and Vw1 in this expression and that of U, the work done per unit weight of water becomes 1 by g into Vw plus Vw1 into U, and if we calculate this, it comes out to be 62.3 Newton meter per second per Newton of water, that is the work done per unit weight. The last part of the question asks the efficiency of the jet, and we have seen that efficiency is output power by input power. In this case, the output work done is calculated per unit weight of water. The efficiency can be written as work done per unit weight of the fluid divided by kinetic energy per unit weight of the fluid, that is kinetic energy head. So, kinetic energy head is V square by 2 g, which is 35 square divided by 2 into 9.81, that is 62.436 Newton meter per second per Newton. And therefore, substituting these two values, the efficiency is given by 62.3 divided by 62.436, that is 0.9978 or 99.78%. That is the answer to the last part of the question. We will continue this discussion in the next lecture. Thank you.